military, and her own party is ultra-nationalist. And so this is very bad news for Papua. It's very bad news for the civil society in Indonesia as well, but it was particularly bad for Papua. So she was responsible for overthrowing Gusdur when he, like as the current president is trying to do, or seems to be trying to do at the moment, the befriending departments, to actually do something decisive to overcome Papuan alienation from Indonesia, and she simply ended that in the parliamentary manoeuvre against Gusdur, which led to his impeachment on a trumped up corruption charge. So she saw off Gusdur, and she saw off her general, saw off KSLOA, as I just said, and the current defence minister who's been imposed on Jokowi, the new president, the current defence minister is also a crony of Megawati's, and he's the one who's, I think, pretty clearly dictated that he would be Jokowi's defence minister, because Jokowi, remember, ran under her party name. He didn't have a party of his own, and he has depended on the established big parties to have the brilliant success that he did have, but of course it's been at a great cost to the way he's able to run the presidency, and he is in fact the weakest president that Indonesia has ever had, and I hope they don't have a weaker president again, because he's just basically become a party puppet of her and completely unable really to prevail against either the military or even or the police. But he's under him, the Anti-Corruption Commission, which did very well under the last president, Yudhoyono, has been seriously undermined in the first few months of Jokowi's term. So that's all by the way, but it's important to have in mind how tough these political leaders are and how close to the military they are, and how the problem in a place like Papua to demilitarise is very difficult, because partly because of this Jakarta politics and the stance of politicians like Megawati, who was ostensibly a reform politician back in the late Suharto days when the manoeuvring began against Suharto, but she's no longer anything like that. And she's not popular, so she didn't want to run for president anymore, because she's been beaten a couple of times already. But anyway, there she is, basically with Jokowi as her puppet to a large extent. So all of this is in the context of how difficult it is to come up for difficult for the Papuans to resist the forces they're up against, and very difficult for civil society in Indonesia to overcome this Suharto. It's basically a Suharto legacy, but the Suharto legacy has been carried forward rather paradoxically by Sukarno's daughter as well. I'm getting back to that. I'm actually slightly obsessed with all that, so I'll be coming back to that more than once yet. So we had Oxus, we had the torpedoing of the second Congress under Teyas Elway. And the Papuans continue to insist on their slogan, Merdeka, which freedom means freedom. So for the Papuans, I'll summarise here, this is a summary of the Papuan grievances really. Land, they're losing it big time to big industrial estates. MIFI, there you are. They're losing, actually it's very Indonesian. In Merauke, the land which has been set aside for agro-industrial development, and not only that, you see it's an integrated food and energy estate, so there's some there's some oil and maybe other kinds of mining involved as well. But the big thing is oil palm and oil palm and rice and forestry. Now, the designated land for all that is actually larger than the Merauke district. So Indonesian statistics and bureaucracy are a thing of of amazement. But anyway, there's about a million hectares already been set aside. A colossal emerging food and energy estate, and it's already displaced villages and ruined village livelihoods in the usual ways, because it begins with logging, and that means pollution of streams, loss of habitat for the animals that are hunted, particularly bad in Meraki. The standard diet is sago, and sago palm suffers with all the other trees that disappear with extensive logging to produce a food industrial estate. So, land, resources, the Freeport mine is the big issue here for the Papuans, and I've said perhaps enough about it already, that this particular resource is both displaced Papuans, has introduced serious public health problems because the army, among other enterprises, and the army, by the way, does all the policing or supplies people, or has retired people who do the policing around the Freeport mine, which has been very much at the expense of the villagers. And they also, the military also have lucrative contracts with the mine to produce food and other things. So providing security and providing food. But security is the big money earner for the army. And the Papuans, of course, would like to have that under their own control, or even have a share of the mine, which the government still hasn't managed to get itself a share of the mine. Health, education, and security. And I've said that OTSUS, Special Autonomy, has failed in those areas to produce funding in those areas. And when the funding comes, you often find situations like the notorious situation in schools, that the teachers, who are mostly settlers from outside Papua, Indonesian settlers from outside, are often absent. So school, there can be a decent school and no teacher, and that's more common than you believe. And salaries aren't stopped. You know, the Indonesian bureaucracy is a wondrous thing. You don't actually have to work. I mean, you have to be around in some sense, not necessarily in Papua, but you have to be actually alive, I suppose, actually a living person, and you'll get paid. And the idea of cutting off a teacher's pay because they don't work is unknown, or more or less unknown. And security and human rights. Now, I want to now do a digression on... A shrunken digression on repression, and say a bit more about it. The key thing is the repression by the military and the police, putting down demonstrations, targeting not just guerrillas in the jungle, but activists, particularly activists, and the carrying out assassinations of targeted activists, which has gone systematically since the original occupation. For all of that, there is virtual impunity. So people who murdered Taya Salawe got light jail sentences, and were actually celebrated by this guy who is now Minister of Defence, forced on Jokowi by Megawati, Riamazar Riachudu is his name. He said they were national heroes. After they had these onerous, very short jail terms announced by the judge, the then army commander announced that they were national heroes. And nobody in Jakarta said no to that. So, what is this repression? I think that a really key document on repression, repression in Indonesia. Now, these two movies that we've had, wonderful movies we've had, or terrifying, horrifying movies that we've had over the last couple of two or three years, from Josh Oppenheimer, and the movies are called The Act of Killing. How many seen that? a spring clean. What a pity. And the new one, which has just been, we helped to launch it in Sydney. We were asked by Human Rights Watch to take part in the launch of, not exactly a launch, but an interview with Josh Oppenheimer himself at the launch. At the launch, at the showing of the movie at the Sydney Film Festival. The second one is called The Look of Silence. That's the one we launched a couple of months ago. Look of Silence, anyone? It's not yet seen. How many?
I haven't seen. I've heard of it.
I've got a copy. Which give you a copy. You can ask Felix. These are incredibly important political documents. These two movies. The first one is about the perpetrators of the killing, mass killings, as the Communist Party got blamed for the attempted coup in 1965. There were mass killings starting in Java and Sumatra and ending up in Bali. And 500,000 at least people died in those mass killings, in which the whole Communist Party was blamed for what a few communists had been involved in. And the coup itself had actually been organised from within the army. But the answer, Suharto's answer to that, once he grabbed power for himself, was to start the mass killing of anybody who could be suspected of leftishness right across the archipelago. And so the first one's about, the actual one's about the perpetrators. The Look of Silence is about the brother of one victim who goes back to where the killing took place in Sumatra. They both said in Sumatra. Goes back to where the killing took place and questions the perpetrators, finds out what they, you know, what they actually exactly did and what they thought and what they now feel and so on. They're both almost unbelievable movies. They're so intimate with the perpetrators and the victims, particularly with the perpetrators. And what emerges from that, and Oppenheimer actually says it he said it at the Sydney Film Festival speech that he gave by Sky. He actually said it. It's this Suhartoist culture and the personalities of the Suharto period, the military and the billionaires, the conglomerate heads, and the bureaucrats, and Negawati, it's a kind of butcher actually. This is the culture and the power and the dominators of Indonesian politics. This is what the victims of 65 are up against, and think how many there actually must be, if 500,000 people, how many relatives and so on, but it must be. But it's a real, still a danger in Indonesia to dig back into that past. Oppenheimer, of course, himself can't go back to Indonesia after making these two movies. And it's an amazing story how he managed to make them. But that's the culture that the whole civil society is up against, even under semi-democratic conditions. But in Papua, the scarcely are semi-democratic conditions at all. In fact, I've got a percentage estimate about the democratic content of Papua and Indonesia later on. But I better start accelerating, yes? Yes? So that's the problem. So what I've tried to do is sketch the extent of repression and the obstacles to actually overcoming it, particularly military impunity. Now, moving on quickly, Third Congress comes up in 2011, remember? 61, 2000, 2011. A third, as it were, anyway, this is another declaration, this time a declaration of a Papuan government, not just independence, but a declaration of a Papuan government. And a Federal Republic of West Papua is actually set up after a big demonstration in Jayapura. And the two leaders of it, their names are on your, if we need to move to. Yes, there they are. Third line. There are the big actors of the Third Congress declared in Jaipur. The Third Congress declaring independence in a way for the third time, but actually more than, it's been declared more than three times. And those two represent one political faction, and that faction has now a base in Melbourne. The Federal Republic of West Papua now has an office in Melbourne. Hands up, how many have been to the office? No, none. How many know about the office for the, yes, okay, ALPA people perhaps know about it. So, that's exile activism. Jacob Rumbiak runs that office. He's designated Foreign Minister of the Federal Republic of West Papua. And he's one of the leading exiled activists. Now there are two other groups. One is Benny Wenda's group, and it's basically a student group, and it's the leadership of it is Highlands. He's a Highland leader himself, and it's in some ways the strongest. This student-led group, the KNPB, the Committee National of Papua Barat, National Committee of West Papua, that is the strongest activist group in West Papua now. It's youth-dominated, it's media-savvy, it's new media-savvy group. Its leader has been, I'm speeding up here, its main leader was assassinated by a group called Densus 88. Who's heard of Densus 88? That's the anti-terror group set up with Australian help and funding. Anti-terror ALEC police detachment with strong Australian involvement that carried out that assassination. They haven't told you that. The Australian government hasn't told you that, but that in fact is what happened. Densus 88 assassinated this man whose name is Tabuni. One of the leaders of KNPB. So that's the Benny Wenda faction, and the third faction is the John Ndwami faction. And John Ndwami has a long Australian history in exile, since he'd been exiled since 1978. He was responsible for getting the Vanuatu government, the only government in the world which has given consistent, strong support for West Papua independence. For West Papua independence, thank you very much. That group set in motion what I'm going to talk about briefly. I'll have to accelerate. Which is West Papua an attempt to become a member of the Melanesian Spearhead Group. Now the MSG, the Melanesian Spearhead Group, is a grouping of five South Pacific small countries, four small countries and one big country, Papua New Guinea. West Papua's been trying to get on it for years. John Ndwami cleared the way for that, and this year the West Papuans got in. John's own movement, the West Papua National Campaign for Liberation, didn't make it as the representative of the West Papuans, but the three groups, the Jacob Rumbiak group, the Benny Wenda group, and the John Ndwami group, which is now being led perhaps by Rex Rumakek, who was a kind of deputy to John Ndwami, also based in Australia, but he's been long-term based in Australia. John actually died earlier in Shuma, just before the West Papuans got observer status inside the Melanesian Spearhead Group. But the big breakthrough really was to get these three factions together, and they are now together, and that is called, It's the United Liberation Movement for West Papua. ULMWP, if you could pronounce that, just try in front of the mirror.